All right, we're going to get started. People are still streaming in, but we're going to kick off this webinar today. And what I'm going to talk to you about is about alignment and variant calling techniques, often bundled as the term secondary analysis. And really, that's such a broad topic. We're going to focus on anything that might be useful in understanding the type of upstream data you get from a sequencing service provider. To be honest, I'm really excited about this content and about talking to you about it today. It's also a little bit daunting to try to fit in as much stuff as I would like to talk about into a 90-minute webinar. I actually researched this content for a talk and actually turned into a short course that I gave just last week at the XGen conference put on by Cambridge Health Institute in San Diego. And that was a 3-hour short course. It was very interactive, a lot of fun, and we spent a lot of time looking at this stuff. So it's going to be a fast clip to get through that same material today. I might not be able to cover all of it, but don't despair. We will have at least 5 different recording devices trying to make sure we capture this content so we can put it up on our website, and you can come back and look at it at your own pace or as a reference material anytime you like. Also worth noting, I'll be giving the same short course. I got invited back to give it in August at Providence, Rhode Island for Cambridge Health Institute's NGS conference. So if you want to be in that sort of interactive learning environment, that'd be a great place to do it. And on a sort of more logistical side, you'll notice that in your GoToMeeting little webinar form, there's a questions pane. Feel free to start asking questions as you think of them. And I will try to, we'll have some time at the end. I'll probably use the full 90 minutes, but feel free to stick around and we'll spend as much time as possible going through and answering your questions. And if you put them in there now, I can go through them and answer them one by one. So use that as much as you would like. And let's talk about what I'd like to accomplish. And one thing I need to do is just assume some level of experience with next generation sequencing technology from you guys. And you know, this is just basically the basic stuff, but what I'm also not assuming is that you snore bioinformatics in your sleep. And to that end, I'm not going to dump a whole bunch of command line tool jargon and command line tool options on the screen. There's definitely a place for that. I attended an Illumina webcast where they're saying how to interpret your genomes, and this is the type of slides you would see where it's basically saying, well, get your data and then use all these tools, and here are some command line options, and have at it. That's your interpretation process. What I hope to focus on more is getting you a broad background of what's kind of data will be delivered through a sequencing service provider, and having the type of skepticism of where those things can go wrong, the places you can generate false positives through all the various steps. And if you can't look at a genome browser pileup and spot a false positive a kilobase away, then I really haven't done my job today. Finally, this is not an interpretation of significance type of webinar. That is a very broad topic in and of itself. And in fact, I'm giving another short course at the Clinical Genome Conference coming up here at June, where I go through the interpretation of my own exomes. So that'd be sort of the next event which you might want to follow up on if you want to hear me talk about that topic. So, and also obviously, this is not a, you know, take your notebooks out and write down the one true way type of webcast, because there is no one true way. We're going to just learn that there's a lot of pros and cons to different techniques, but hopefully those pros and cons become useful in and of themselves. So why do I have a background and, you know, sort of the authority to speak in this sense? Let's just say that it's something I had to learn as part of a role in running a product department and in providing customer support and services to our large and growing customer base as a company. We have hundreds of users worldwide, and we also have been our software, SNP and Variation Suite being our primary commercial tool here. It's been cited by a number of folks, but we've also really focused on next generation sequencing technology in the last year or so, have a broad spectrum of a background in SNP and copy number analysis as well. But so one, we have to deal with all the upstream data, as it were, because this is a tertiary analysis product. We start with variant calls. But two, we've built our own genome browser and we're giving this away for free, where we really have to understand all the details of the types of things that show up in file formats, how those things are different from platform to platform. And three, we also spend time building our own secondary pipelines, whether it's the RNA-seq pipeline we built in conjunction with EA, now a Quintiles company, or providing services to our customers who come to us with FastQ data and would like to get to some meaningful results. So that's kind of a little background of why at times I'm snoring bioinformatics in my sleep. But let's also spend some time getting to some common terminology. And what I hope to do here is just define these things so we can talk about primary, secondary, and tertiary analysis without that being ambiguous, but not necessarily, you know, give you a NGS 101 background. Again, I'm going to assume some level of experience there. But here's how I'm defining primary, secondary, and tertiary analysis. To start with, these are sort of the three stages that your data goes through when you're looking at next-generation sequencing data. And primary analysis is largely a solved problem, or at least, let's say, and from your perspective, a problem that's solved by the hardware vendors themselves. If you are Illumina, you write software that knows how to read the illuminescence that you're reading off of a HiSeq or a MiSeq, and you're doing a lot of work on the machine or writing your own software to provide the quality scores and base calls for your NGS data. Secondary analysis is really all this work that can be put into a automated single sample at a time pipeline where you clean up the reads, you line it or do assembly, and prepare it for downstream analysis, usually doing things like variant calling. And the downstream analysis or the sense making is where you incorporate all of your samples into an experiment-specific workflow, and it can take on a lot of shapes. We're not going to necessarily get into all those details here, but it is important to kind of be aware of what your downstream experiment design is, because that does sometimes affect how you do secondary analysis. For example, cancer workflows can have a very different secondary analysis when looking for somatic mutations than germline mutations. So from a primary analysis perspective, what you need to know is that the sequencing service providers are trying to just give you high quality base pairs for their reads, but along with each AGC and T is a quality score saying how confident it is, and as the machine might have on a specific base lower confidence, that information is used very heavily in the downstream analysis to essentially detect what might be sequencing errors versus true mutations in your sequence data. And for the desktop machines, the PGMs, you know, Protons and MiSeq, a lot of this happens either on the machine or on the little box that gets bundled with the machine. With a high throughput machine like a HiSeq 2000, there's a lot of work that does happen on the machine, but the base calling is something that needs to be done with Illumina's Cassava software on your network after the machine finishes its run on your local grid with your local compute. And that's actually quite an intensive step by itself, but you're using their tools and essentially just kicking it off in a relatively standardized fashion. On the secondary side, there's two major components that break down kind of what you're doing in terms of, at least on the DNA side, how you go about taking those raw reads and moving them forward. If you're working in a model organism, you most likely have a finished genome. And by finished genome, I mean of the quality, or at least near the quality of our human reference, which took, you know, $1 billion and so many years to get to, was based on these Sanger sequenced back clones. And these are high quality, usually full chromosome length contigs or contiguous sequences. And although those have been increasing, the number of finished genomes we have available to us, more exponentially is this growth of draft genomes, which are cheaper to generate using just the raw amounts of data we're able to produce with next-generation sequencing. But because our NGS data is, our high-throughput data is relatively short in the length of the reads, you get these contigs that are only 10 to 100 kilobases in size. So through a gigabase-sized genome or more, you're getting thousands of these little guys. And it can be considered a reference, and certainly people work with draft genomes as their reference, but there are issues that are come up by having all these small little contigs to work with. Now, with next-generation technology, there are things like PacBio machines producing long read lengths and optical mapping, such as OpGen's product, that can give you sort of the scaffold for constructing genomes that have much larger contig sizes. This is sort of a hybrid approach. But what's important to note here, though, is that from a secondary perspective, these are completely different ball games. Assembly takes a huge amount of memory versus alignment can be something you can often run on a single relatively normal sized machine. And we're going to talk about aligning to the reference through the rest of this, because that is a very common use case, especially when dealing with things like human, which have a very high quality reference. Now, let's talk about the human reference sequence for a second. It is important to understand this, and for a couple of reasons. To start with, how often does it change? Well, since I've been really playing ball in this field, we started off with the NCBI 36 reference in March 2006, and we transitioned in February 2009 to the GRCH 37 reference, and GRCH is now the consortium that will be moving the human reference sequence forward. It's important to note, though, that this canonical reference, which includes the 22 chromosomes and our autosomes, has not changed in the way that we think of it since February 2009. They continue to find issues with this reference, and they consider those patches. And there have been 11 patch releases since. But these patches, which are essentially changes that fix certain regions, might affect many, many bases, are not in a reference that you would use to align against, because our annotations and all that need this perfect example or this exact same sequence in which we've been working with. So this summer, we'll get a new reference sequence which incorporates all those patches, and it will be a completely different coordinate system. The chromosomes will be different lengths. Every single base position that you talk about now has to be adjusted for that. And can you imagine how much data we will have to lift over or regenerate? So this is definitely going to be a long and arduous process to move to a new reference. Two other important things to recognize about the reference. One is, although we do have our canonical chromosomes, we also have what we call supercontigs, which are these big contigs that we know are quite large, and you have reads and genes in them, but we don't know exactly where they fit within a chromosome. Sometimes we have them sort of localized to a chromosome, or we don't even know which chromosome they're on. These are things you can align to, but are largely ignored from most perspectives, but there are some genes that fall legitimately within these supercontigs. The second thing is that the reference sequence consortium does not define a mitochondrial reference. So when they came out with their new GRCH 37 in 2009, the UCSC folks, which is the largest sort of online repository of annotations and genome browsing, they grabbed their existing mitochondrial from NCBI 36, and they defined their human reference as HG19, and all of their annotations are based on that. The Thousand Genomes Consortium, when they decided that they were going to be serious about sequencing all these humans and creating these giant alignment files, they decided that they wanted to use the revised Cambridge reference sequence for the mitochondrial, which is considered a much improved mitochondrial reference. So they call their assembly G1K, and not only does it include that, it includes the herpes virus as well as some supercontigs, but not any of the alternative loci. I'll talk about that in a second. And they have a decoy sequence for other pieces of DNA that will, if not provided a decoy, will map sort of across different places and essentially decrease the quality of your alignments. So this is generally considered the best reference for using if you're doing exome or genome-based DNA-seq, because it is optimized for that type of purpose. But again, annotations for the mitochondrial are completely not comparable between these two. They use a different mitochondrial reference. So let's talk about what these patches look like. You know, these 200 patches we'll be seeing in GRCH 38. And some of these are actually very significant, and you should be aware of this patch system, because if you're looking at a certain site, it might be worth going to their website and looking to see if your site is affected by one of these patches. What these patches are doing is essentially trying to fix places where the choice of these back clone tiling paths of where they switch from one path to another has negatively infected the sort of research quality of the reference genome. Essentially, this might be switching from one human's reference to another. And in this case, this switch created a version of this ABO gene that does not exist in nature. If you were to create the spliced version of this gene by essentially including two back clones right where they did, the ABO gene was a null allele. It was not present in the humans, and it was not an mRNA would ever actually be expressed. So their patch fixed this, and they changed essentially where the splice site was, and so that's something to be aware of, essentially because you can you can see actually alignment artifacts also due to these locations that are potentially affected by patches to the human reference. Okay, so let's talk about what your reference-based alignment gives you. And what it really gives you is where everything matches, you have a read that goes to the reference and it sits there and every single base in that read matches, you know, you're essentially just defining that your sample matches the reference. But where it doesn't match, you have, you know, what we call variants. And the common class or the simplest class of variants are single nucleotide variants. So you can abbreviate that SNVs. You can still call them SNPs, although the word polymorphisms is supposed to talk about things in a population perspective when you're talking about a single individual. Probably the correct term is variants, but these are interchangeable terms. And it's essentially defining where you have an alternative to the reference. So we sometimes talk about things as the reference allele and the alternate allele. Keep in mind, though, that reference is not always major. There are many sites in the genome in which the choice of the samples that were used in the bat clones, the 40-some people from Buffalo, New York, happened to have alleles that did not reflect the major allele or extremely rare even. And so there are plenty of ways in which you can look at that, but the allele frequency information from DB SNP or 1000 genomes is one. The other is that you can also have sites in which the reference allele is not even common enough to be represented in your sample set. So your samples might have more than one alternate allele. This is actually a pileups of my own exomes, my wife's and my son's. And at this individual site, you can see, you can think of these as histograms of the number of alleles at each base supported by the reads. And in this case, you know, well-covered 200 base region, all of the reads supported a T, and my wife has an A. Well, the only reason this site is interesting is because the reference here is actually a C. So we both have alternatives to the reference. We have two alternates present, and my son inherited this obviously in a recessive fashion or in a heterozygous state, getting one of our chromosomes from my mother or from his mother and one from his father. And this site is actually has two alternatives to the reference of a C. The DB SNP location here draws all three alleles that have been cataloged in the presence of all the samples that have gone into DB SNP. The only reason this is interesting is because the genotype that was called for this was incorrect. It called this as a homozygous alternate. And the only reason it was incorrect is because the variant calling tool was set up to call only a single alternate allele along with a reference, and having two alternate alleles that are not, you know, neither of which are the reference, essentially confounded it and had to pick which one it thought it was, and so it thought it was an A. So these false positives can be systematically weeded out, but it's an example of the concept of a single reference and a single alternate potentially confounding your downstream tools. And so we think we're pretty good at single nucleotide variants. They get called generally very consistently. And obviously, if you're looking at a pileup with 200 reads and 100 come from one chromosome, 100 from the other, and you get this type of ratio, it's a no-brainer. You can look at this a mile away and see what it is. But Golson-Lyons group did a little bit of consensus between five different variant callers, and actually only 60% of them had the exact same genotype called. And so there can definitely be some outliers here, but it is important to realize, especially if you look at novel variants, not in DB SNP, where only 12% are concordant, there's a lot of places in the genome that are still confounding when calling SNPs. The next thing to look at here is small insertions and deletions. And you can think of these as length polymorphisms, because it's essentially where your sample has more or fewer bases than in the reference. And these can be extremely important from a functional perspective, because if you insert one or two alleles into a coding sequence of a gene, the remaining three base amino acid sequences are all shifted over and the rest of the protein is encoded in a completely different manner. These are generally considered loss of function variants by themselves. So they're extremely important as a class of variants. But they are very hard to call consistently. And if you look at the concordance between this, it's not even worth showing. It's just darn poor, less than 10%. And one of the reasons is, and not the only reason, but one of the difficulties is they're no longer unambiguous how you define a mutation in terms of a insertion or deletion. So look at these two sequences. Let's say this is the reference and this is the alternate. You know, it has an extra T in this little homeopolymer length of T's. and here's the positions. Do you call this as a insertion of a T at position 5 here, or an insertion of a T at position 1? Well, really, you could choose any of these positions. And it doesn't really matter which you choose, it just matters that you're consistent across all of your samples, and you're consistent when comparing this to a population catalog like dbSNP or the 1000 genomes, etc. Complete Genomics, for example, in their version 1 pipeline, which is quite old by now, always called it at the tail end of homopolymers, but they have since updated to be consistent with most tools, which now call it at the beginning end of this run. And finally, this is just a short mention, multinucleotide polymorphisms, where you might have like an AG mutated to a CG or something like that, are their own class and can have their own difficulties in both their annotations and their variant calling. So the next thing you actually get with whole genome data is you can actually look at where your sample has copy number variations. Now, we generally consider copy number variations to be things greater than 10 kilobases or so, maybe even greater than 1 kilobases, but in terms of how you call these, right now we're pretty accurate above the 10 kb range and more problematic in this 1 kb to 10 kb range. And this is not myself saying this. I was listening to Steve Shear from SickKids talking about this at AGBT, and this is his data while looking at a lot of copy number variation with autism samples. Now, you can detect these with a number of different techniques. I won't go into it too much, but the important thing here is that you do need to know what your baseline is. So if you're looking at somatic versus normal, you can always just compare, look for somatic mutations, and normalize against your normal samples. Otherwise, you need some sort of population panel to know what your normal is, because what you always do is look at your coverage in terms of these log ratios between your sample and the quote normal. And you can do this across the whole genome and actually see sites where the log ratio consistently goes into higher or lower than the sort of baseline of zero, and call these regions. It's very similar to actually how you do it with array CGH, except for instead of these points being probes, they're essentially bins of coverage. But this is kind of what one looks like in terms of a genome browse pileup. You see the coverage here is consistently about 50, and then you have a 2x amplification, and the coverage is consistently about 100, and then it drops back down. And obviously, there's a little bit of variability in where you define the start and stop, but this is a much higher definition information than what you would have with array CGH. And finally, a very complicated class of mutations is structural variations, and these can include things like balance rearrangements, where you have a little piece of one chromosome and a little piece of another sort of swap places, inversions, where you have a chromosome piece sort of flip around, translocations, and other types of complex things like whole little pieces shattering and rearranging, and very, very difficult to actually sort out. The signal here, though, in next-generation sequencing data is actually quite nice. You have things like paired-end read mappings, and we'll talk about this a little bit, but really I won't have time to go into this much more. Depth of coverage and split read mappings to really see if there's, you know, these structural variations, but these can be extremely important biologically and from an interpretation perspective, because you might have a site where a gene over here and a gene over here are essentially fused, and that fusion gene can have huge implications, and in fact, it's amazing to me that this occurs, but there's a specific fusion genes that are actually quite common in certain leukemias and quite common to how their pathogenesis progresses and how you treat it. So detecting these things in certain applications can be extremely valuable. This is a fun example of what a translocation looks like, an inversion. At this site to this site, and this was called with complete genomics, but I'm looking at Illumina data here, which is 100 base pair paired end mappings. There's actually this whole chunk of DNA from this site to this site was sort of flipped around, and there's two ways you can see this. One, at the breakpoints, there's a bunch of mismatches in the reads. This is the coverage, and this is the reads themselves. And two, this paired end data, which I have stacked in paired end fashion, normally you see one forward read followed by about 300 bases and one reverse read, and this is this is essentially the insertion length of this long fragment here. When those reads span this breakpoint, you can see it goes from forward to forward, or when it spans this breakpoint, it goes from reverse to reverse. So you know that the DNA has been flipped here in terms of the sample versus the reference. So just a really great example. But notice that this type of stuff can potentially confound variant calling. Obviously, if you're looking at this breakpoint and you don't have that context that there's an inversion here, you might think there's a whole mess of mutations. Okay, and so finally, I'm not going to get into this in too much detail, but tertiary analysis may have some very implicit expectations of what's coming from the upstream, especially if you're looking at somatic variant identification. But what you really need to often care about is if you're looking for things like rare functional variants, you know, what level of depth would you call your mutations versus if you're doing something like population studies where you're less looking at the pathogenic or potential causal implications of a single variant and looking at sort of a burden of variants, in which case you might be able to do lower depth genomes or exomes and allow for a little more individual mutation or error rates or false positive rates. And obviously I'm talking about DNA-seq. RNA-seq has its own implications in what you do from an alignment perspective. You usually align to the transcriptome, or you are trying to assemble a transcriptome. This has a huge implication because when you're a transcriptome being essentially the spliced versions of our genes that are sitting in genomic space, some of those intron gaps can be thousands of bases away. So the aligner needs to know how to either align a read that has part of it in one place and another part 1,000 bases away, or you need to pre-splice that transcriptome and align directly to the spliced version. But in most of these cases, what you're not looking at is individual mutations, but sort of the abundance of reads that fall relative from one sample to another into each of these functional units, whether it's RNA-seq, ChIP-seq, or methylation-seq. Okay, so I want to spend a little bit of time sort of pumping the pipes here, talking about why we care about all this upstream stuff. I mean, at the end of the day, shouldn't we just get some good data and expect that we can just only care about that? The first off, it's, you know, and just to motivate why we even spend our time with NGS with all of its, you know, huge orders of magnitude of data at all, is that there's so much promise in this type of data in a lot of different applications, whether you're doing clinical research and finding, you know, diagnoses that were hard to get to, whether you're looking at setting up a desktop sequencer and doing gene by gene or gene panels to end sort of gene by gene hunts. There's a lot of clinical applications where this already makes huge economic sense. I would also note that, you know, our CEO recently attended ACMG last week, and compared to the year before, the general consensus on the clinical side is that NGS is something we're excited about. There's obviously issues. We have to concern ourselves about quality and reproducibility and reporting and all these things. But let's just, you know, strap our boots on and get to work, because it's obviously something we're going to do. It's not a question of if, but when and how fast we can get this going. Compared to a year ago, where there was a lot more sort of moaning about how difficult it was and how poor some of the variants were in some certain sites. So the promise is huge. But why you care about your upstream is that there's areas in every part of the upstream process, whether from library preparation to the sequencing itself to the secondary analysis, that can confound your analysis and essentially give you a hard time in getting to that meaningful interpretation or whatever type of analysis experiment design you have. I don't think I have time really to go into each of these, but needless to say, there's a couple that are quite important. You know, almost every library prep requires PCR amplification. Duplicate, having a one individual fragment have an enormous level PCR duplicates can confound, for example, if you're calling a heterozygous variant and half of your reads are coming from a side that has PCR duplication, it can dramatically and sort of artificially alter the ratio of reads from one chromosome to another, right? And so you expect to always have sort of an even sampling of reads across individual pieces of DNA. So all these things provide sources of sequencing error and error in your downstream analysis results. Most of this came from this great blog, Sequencing Data, I Want the Truth, You Can't Handle the Truth, and some supplementary research I did by looking at this paper comparing a lot of the desktop sequencing machines. Another type of issue that we really need to focus on, and I'll talk about later, is the fact that there are regions of the genome that have high homology in large chunks. 98% of this region is similar to that region for, you know, hundreds of KB even. And reads aligned there can really have a difficulty being uniquely aligned, and the multi-mapping can cause sequencing or variant calling errors. And finally, a note on your choice of technologies here. Sometimes, though, you really don't have much of a choice. If you want to sequence whole genomes yourself, your pretty much only game in town is going to a HiSeq 2000. With their 600 gigabases of throughput, that's really the only place you can get enough sequence data to do a whole shotgun sequencing of a genome. On the exome side, you have the HiSeq, and now the new game in town is the Ion Torrent Proton. On the targeted side, if you're looking at just gene panels or just a couple of genes, you can use Amplicon or other types of target enrichments. You got the MiSeq, the PGM, and obviously everything else as well, depending on how much you want to barcode and multiplex your samples. Important to note, though, that we're now, thankfully, at a place where almost all these platforms are giving us reads over 100 bases. When we were looking at reads in the 36-50 base pair length, it was really hard to call some of these things like insertions and deletions, even at the 5 base pairs, 8 base pair length. With these longer reads, at least we're in the point where data coming off these machines are going to catch a lot of the most common mutations and with higher confidence. Certainly, though, this is nowhere near the point of sequencing entire genes in one stretch. If you look at PacBio, they do have really nice long reads, but they have a really high raw error rate. So there's a very different type of application where you would make that trade-off and go in that. Some things like building your own assemblies or doing some validations. All of these have some very interesting technology down the pipe, but I'll let you sort of evaluate that on your own terms. Okay, so we've been blazing through the background here, and we know what SNPs, indels look are in terms of, you know, things compared to the reference. Let's go ahead and jump on over to Genome Browse, which is, again, a free a tool that you can download from our website. But what we're going to do is use this to just show us a couple sites that are clean SNPs, as well as some sites that, you know, can be problematic and why you need to look at this data down at the read level. So this is Genome Browse. This is version 1.1, which we've just recently shipped just yesterday, and includes some things like supporting VCF files. What I'm looking at here is actually one VCF file, annotations of OMIM and RefSeq. Let me sort of put the two gene-based guys beside each other, some population frequencies, and three different BAM files. These BAM files actually represent the data coming from a exome. This is 1,000 genomes data, high quality or high depth, 100 base pair paired-end reads. The child here is NA12878. We're going to talk about the same data in terms of genomes later on, but we're going to jump around here on the exome. And I just have this zooming into chromosome 5 here. You can see we can actually look at, you know, alternative human references versus other species. We have annotations for almost, you know, most reference and sequenced genomes out there. And this is our little tree of all of our graph nodes. We can turn things on and off as we like. But what I really love is that you can use this to stay within, to keep the context of what you're looking at as you zoom in. So I'm using my scroll wheel on my mouse. You can switch your zoom mode over here and kind of click and drag as well. But I'm sort of a Google Maps junkie and like that scroll wheel effect. Let's go ahead and start zooming in to a gene level. And as we pop into the gene level, this is very typical of exome data. You can see that we're targeting each of these genes, and our pileups show, you know, 100, 200 read depth in those regions. And I have a little mark here, and I'm going to keep zooming in on. You can see our frequency data. NHLBI is an exome-based variant catalog, so its variants are only on these little islands of these genes. And 1,000 genomes covers the whole genome. Let's go ahead and zoom into a single base resolution. I'm going to click and drag and move this sucker around. And here is a variant that's called, and here's the VCF file, as a homozygous variant, which is, if you look at the reads, looks very convincing. I can click on this and see that at this site, 180 reads supported that T, and the rest are probably in the sequencing error range. And I have both the child and the two parents, and the parents are both heterozygous, so this is a nice example of a recessively inherited variant, and it's right in the middle of a gene, so we can do things like interpret that, but that's not the point of this webinar. What I do want to show you is how, when you look at this data from sort of a perspective of the reads themselves, this falls right within the island of capture, really high depth. There's both forward and reverse. I'm stacking them above and below the x-axis. I can stack them all above if I want to as well. And you know, there's no reason not to believe this variant. It's extremely high depth. It would validate with Sanger with very high confidence. So let's go and look at another example. And this one, actually, you might initially look at this site and think that you're looking at a heterozygous variant, because when you look at it, it looks like half the reads support the A and half support the T. But if I scroll up to my VCF file, it was called as an AA. If I click on it, I can see the genotype was AA, even though the site is, the reference is a C and the alternate is a T, the genotype's an AA. So why does it look like it might look like a heterozygous variant? Let's scroll down and expand this up so we can really take a look at what's going on at this site. I'm going to place my mouse anchor here so we can zoom out a little bit and still look at it. Okay, so it's in this region that's a little bit lower coverage, but notice all these gray reads. If I click on these individual reads, what's going on is that they have very low mapping quality. If you look here on the left, and if I scroll down, I look at the details for this read, and this is an individual read coming off the sequencer, the aligner said that this had three places in which it could have easily gone. So if I look at my, so in other words, this is a region that has reads that map to multiple places of the genome. There's probably a a superdupe in this region, a region of high homology. So what I can do to clean this up is switch my pileup view to filter out these multi-mapped reads. Boom, nice and clean view here. The coverage still shows the original depth in this hashed pileup, but if I zoom in, I can see, if I click on this, there's a only 20 reads, or clean 20 reads support this with high main quality. And so this is a homozygous variant, and the variant caller was correct to call it homozygous. So let's go ahead and jump on over now to a third location. And this location is great here. I'm going to pull this up. Da-da-da-dum. Because it actually shows a couple different things. One, it shows an insertion, and in the pileup you can see these insertions as little I bars. When you hover over them, you can see there's a G inserted with 28 reads supporting it, and then a GT inserted with 28 reads supporting it here as well. And if we look at our parent samples, it looks like they have much fewer reads out of the total, 13. So these are sort of heterozygous insertions, and in fact it's a recessively inherited pair of insertions. But if we look up at our VCF, we can see that the variant caller thought that this was an insertion of a GT followed by a heterozygous SNP followed by an insertion of a GT. Now, what's up with that heterozygous SNP, and do we think this is a heterozygous or homozygous insertion? Okay, let's set this anchor and zoom out to see what our context looks like. Okay, so what's really going on here is all these individual reads that have the G do not have the two insertions. In fact, an aligner always prefers to have about, you know, three or four mismatches than to have these insertions. So when the insertions don't only are on the tail end of reads, or when the read at this site is sort of near its end, it's adding these mismatches rather than the insertion. But you can have high confidence then that this is a clean homozygous pair of insertions, and that G is not a real SNP. That's just an artifact of the alignment not catching these insertions. Now, a local realignment of this would clean this up, and that's something tools often do these days. There's another thing to note here in terms of the interpretation and why you would use a tool like this to really look at this site. If you were to use an interpretation tool that says, give me, you know, loss of function variants, it would look at this G insertion and say, well, that's a loss of function variant. I'm right in the middle of this gene, and I've inserted a single base at this site. And so now the rest of the gene is now frame shifted and will no longer encode the same proteins. And I can look at each protein being encoded here. But If you look at the local context, there's two insertions, and it's homozygous, so it's in both chromosomes. And in total, they insert a GT here and a G here. So in total, there's three bases inserted in the sample compared to the reference. So it's an in-frame insertion. Although it will change and add a new amino acid, the remaining amino acids will be the same. So even though we're right in the middle of this exon, this may not be a loss of function mutation, and you would have to use a tool to sort of validate the effect of that extra amino acid versus the reference, but it's certainly not a loss of function variant. So those are some of my favorite examples just looking at this exome data. We're going to come back to Genome Browse and look at whole genome data for the same thing. In fact, I'm going to open up the project just so it's nice and ready here. But we're going to look at the same data, whole genome coverage in a little bit. But let's jump back over to visualizing or going through some more background here. So if we looked at our agenda, where we wanted to be at this point was starting to talk about the bioinformatics of your secondary analysis. And what I hope to cover in this section is just touch on some of the tools, and certainly I can't touch on all of them, but the ones that you are often going to see, as well as the file formats that you're going to see, and give you enough understanding of those that you won't just be scared away and not look at them when appropriate, as well as the type of filtering and stuff that you look at when cleaning up things like the raw data coming off of these tools. And finally, we'll touch on visualization as well. Okay, so the first thing to keep to start off with, and really where the data starts, is a FASTQ file format. And it's essentially a FASTA, which is just a series of sequences followed by the extra Q, because it includes not just the sequences, but also a quality score. Now, there's three important lines here, although they're in lines of four. The first line here is a sequence identifier, and this is machine generated, often including sort of the location and run name of the machine that produced it. It's important though, because this is intended to be a unique string that identifies this read. This read may be who knows how long, but this unique string can track it. And if you see the same string in multiple sites in the genome, then that same read has been aligned to multiple sites in the genome. Then you have your series of AGCTs, and this is just what the text file format looks like. And then you have this little plus, and it can potentially have the same identifier repeated. And then you have the quality scores. Now, although this looks like gibberish, all you're doing is encoding a range of numeric values of quality scores, which are FRED scaled numbers saying how confident each of these bases, so the Y goes to the C, etc. You're encoding that as characters that can be printed on the screen. This essentially gets translated back into numbers when computer programs read it. And you can do things like take the millions of reads that are in this sequence, there'll be one set of four lines followed by another, and compress it into a FASTQGZ file format, or run some statistics on how high that quality is for each of these bases. So at position one, what is the average sort of plot, and you know, box and whisker plot for that base? But as you see, and this is very typical of Illumina data, as you get to the tail end of this data, and this is actually getting out to 95 or 100 bases, the quality tends to drop off. And this is, you know, sort of based on how Illumina sequencing technology works. So the median here is actually dropping and as well as sort of the tail ends of this distribution. This is important for some reasons for secondary analysis, because you might end up trimming these reads to clean them up if your aligner is not able to do that for you. BWA, for example, can auto-trim tail ends of reads, but Bowtie cannot. I'll talk about those tools in a second. So that's the type of things you might be needing to know about. Also, if you're getting the fast cues from that first step coming right off the machine, the first couple bases may be the barcode if you have multiple samples going into a single library being sequenced on a single lane of a MiSeq or a HiSeq, or a single run or chip of an ion torrent machine. And finally, if you have paired end information, what you actually have is two FASTQ files, and they are in perfect tandem. So the first line represents the same read, you know, forward and reverse strand, and the second line, you know, the second pair of lines will be the second pair of data. But there's two files that need to be passed around to your secondary tools. The next important file format is the SAM or BAM file, SAM being the text version and BAM being the binary version. And the specification in the reference implementation is SAM tools. The author, Hen Lee, is just this extremely prolific bioinformatician, often goes by the tag LH3 on his source code and forums. But in the SAM version, what you're essentially getting is information, and one thing to keep in mind is it contains all the same information that was actually in your FASTQ file is in here, but also you get information about where that FASTQ sequence goes, aligns to the reference. So this is about the alignment data, and all of the supplementary information is about how it aligns, and the programs themselves might have some custom tags that they put in there, such we are looking at that BWA saying, I have three places that I could have aligned this. So all those types of custom tags are things you can see in Genome Browse as you click on reads. But a single read gets its alignment. And you know, this cigar string, although it looks scary, is essentially saying, as we align it to and sort of roll it down onto the genome, how many places are matches versus the 2i means there's two bases that were inserted compared to the reference, and then four more matches, one base that was deleted compared to the reference, and then three more matches. So this is essentially defines the data that we are visualizing when we're looking into these reads aligned to the genome in Genome Browse. And finally, BAM is the binary version of this. Not only is it compressed, so don't try to, you know, zip this data up. You're not going to get anywhere with it. It's actually already compressed. But it's compressed in a way that allows for it to be indexed, so tools like Genome Browse can jump to a single gene and only read data relevant to that gene, whereas the rest of the file might be 100 gigabases or 100 gigabytes. And in fact, the whole genome data we'll be looking at barely fits on a 2 terabyte hard drive that I have attached to my computer right now. So of that 2 terabytes, we're going to be zooming around and looking at a small fraction of that. Okay. So that's the important things to know about SAM file. And the next thing is, after your alignment, you'd call variants, and the VCF file stands for variant call format is the most common standard here. It was defined by the 1000 Genomes group. We're now at version 4.1, and it's also commonly compressed and indexed. And when Genome Browse opens a VCF file, if you just have a plain text VCF file, which you can open in a text editor even, we'll do the compression and indexing for you alongside that file. If you do open it in a text editor, this is what you see. You know, the first n lines here just look like these header fields. And then you get to this tab-separated file format. And you can actually import that into Excel or something, because it will, you know, it's very clean. You have the first column is your chromosome, then your position, then often your RSID. Then you define which base is the reference and which is the alternates at that site, a quality information for the site. You can define some pre-baked filters. And so if you have like a filter like Q10, you can go up into the header and it will say filter Q10 means the quality is below 10. So these are sort of flags for this site. And then it starts to look a little more complicated, because what we're essentially doing is allowing for any site to have any arbitrary key value pairs. So this info field is site level key value pairs. And we define these up in the header. So NS3 means NS stands for number of samples, and 3 means there's 3 samples. More important ones are things like DP, which is the total depth at this site. And so DP of 10 means that this site there was 14 bases. Similarly, you can have any number of key value pairs and any number of samples, and that's an important distinction. Although you often get VCF files that are a single sample per VCF file, you can also have any number of samples in a single file, in which case every sample then gets to define what it gets, what information is present, but all samples for a given location have the same values defined. The most important ones here are GT, which stands for genotype, GQ, which stands for genotype quality, and DP, which stands for read depth. So we won't get into how those are encoded, but genotype quality is essentially the FRED score saying how likely is it that this genotype is the correct one that's defined versus the any other genotype present. And GT can actually define both reference versus a heterozygous versus a homozygous, and a 1 here means alternate allele, and a 0 means the reference. So a 0-0 is reference, and a 1-0 is heterozygous. Okay, let's talk about the tools of the trade here then for a second. And again, I can't get into detail on every single one of these, but there are 2 very popular aligners that you should know about, and their trade-offs between using one versus the other. So the first one is BWA, also by Lee H., and it's intended to be a quick aligner, and so it's taking some shortcuts here compared to some of the more, well, let's just put it this way. Alignment as a technology or an algorithm from a computer science perspective was really solved in the 1980s when Smith and Watterson wrote a paper that defined how to get the optimal alignment between any two species, or you consider your sample versus the reference as the same type of problem. The problem is the Smith-Waterman algorithm is computationally expensive like crazy, so you can't use it to do whole genome alignment of 100 million reads to a, you know, 3 or 4 gigabase reference sequence. So that's the trade-off, is all of these tools then do some optimizations, and their optimizations are sacrificing a little bit of accuracy for making it even feasible to do this type of alignment. Now, BWA is probably the most often used for doing DNA alignments to the reference genome. It allows for there to be gaps or differences in length between the reads you're looking at and the reference. So these are called gapped alignments. Bowtie, also very, very fast, actually a little bit faster, does not allow for these gaps, but it is actually a little bit faster than BWA. And so if you're doing things like RNA-seq, that's not a problem. You care more about how many counts fall in a gene rather than having the perfect alignment that gives you good variant calling. Bowtie 2 does support local gapped alignments and longer reads. It does sacrifice some on the specificity, and they're still sort of rapidly developing this method. BWA also just recently came out with a version, BWA-SW, standing for Smith-Waterson, that does do sort of a hybrid and handle longer reads better. So basically, it's important to note that most of these aligners only allow for a certain number of mismatches between a specific read and the alignment before it sort of gives up, or it's sort of fundamental to the algorithm. There are these other types of aligners like NovaAlign, Elan, SOAP, and MAC that have the seed and expand strategy, where they take part of your read, they look it up sort of a hash table, and they figure out where they are and sort of expand out. Sometimes these can allow for a lot more number of mismatches. They're usually significantly slower. They may or may not allow for gapped alignments. And then there's a whole other set of aligners specifically designed for aligning the RNA space, where you have splice sites, and you're either looking at the spliced form or the unspliced form of that in the genome. Now, most of these aligners can take advantage of paired end sequencing technology, where you have a read followed by an insertion gap and another read, which essentially gives you a fragment that will sort of feel longer than the individual read, and that information can often improve the number of things you can align to the genome, as well as some of the accuracy. Okay, so I mentioned this a little bit earlier, but you know, indels being such a problematic site, one of the strategies people have come up with is use these fast aligners to simply place reads into the general relative site of where it goes in the genome, and then use a more computationally expensive, but when you're looking at it, a small site, palpable to a different algorithm to realign and either create like a little de novo scaffold right beside your reference and then do a Smith-Waterman between that scaffold and the reference, or just simply clean up the fact that when you're aligning individual reads, you may choose for this little homopolymer run here, if there's a deletion, your aligner, because it's looking at things read by read, may put the deletion at this position in one read and this position in another read, and if you can get those just to agree on where they're at, you at least have a better chance of calling the variant. So there's a number of tools to do this. Two common ones used are GATK, which I'll talk about in a second. Although it's a toolbox in and of itself, it does allow for local realignments, as well as PNDEL, which has more of an approach of the build a scaffold and align it back to the reference. Both of these are really learning from a lot of the groundbreaking work Complete Genomics did with their original bioinformatics they provided with their complete genome sequence, where they introduced local realignment of indels. The important thing to keep in mind is that there are still problematic regions, and these can be places like CPG sites that are just hard to get in general, and actually can be just from systematic sequencing errors as well. Okay, from a variant calling perspective, again, I could go on forever on all these, but the ones you really need to know about are SAM tools. And it's a, like I mentioned, this is the reference of the SAM-BAM specification, but they also have this tool called mpileup that computes these adjusted quality scores at each site. And it's a pretty aggressive adjustment. It's very conservative in what it does. I mean, it will essentially not call sites near indels and all this type of stuff, but it also performs a little local realignment on the fly, and it will give you some default filters, and you can apply your own filters on top of that to give you a site of variance, and it can output then through a couple of extra passes through other tools, etc. If you're a command line junkie, you can get this into a VCF file pretty easily. Now, GATK is probably the most prolifically used. It was actually sort of developed in the context of the 1000 Genome Project and, you know, is sponsored by grants under the Broad Institute. And they are continuing to move their development forward. But the Unified Genotyper, which was developed in the context of calling these low-depth genomes for the 1000 Genomes Project. They had 1,000 genomes, each sequence at a depth of 6x. In general, anything less than 10x is considered ultra-low-depth. And these tools are, you know, GATK had all these ways in which they would, through heuristics and realignments and recalibrations, be able to call these low-depth genotypes relatively confidently, and they called them across all the samples concurrently. Now, that has its pluses and minuses. It also does allow for local indel realignment as well as a bunch of these other tools to clean up the data. It is worth noting, though, that calling those things in concurrent can introduce its own artifacts. I'll talk about that in a second. And finally, if you're looking at what comes with your machine, Illumina actually provides their own alignment and variant calling. And if you look at our deliverables of our Illumina Genome Network, they'll be using that. Similarly, IonTorrent provides their own variant calling, which knows how to handle some of the sequencing technology specific issues with homopolymers, etc. And so, at the end of the day, you might not have to think too much about this, but it is worth noting that these tools come with their own trade-offs. Now, quality score recalibration is kind of something that, it was discovered that this may reduce the number of false positives and then has been generally widely adopted. But remember, those per-base quality scores that go along the machine cycle, the read length, if you look at sort of what the theoretical versus actual distribution based on the different technology, it can be quite messy. So recalibrating that, and especially with specific dinucleotides being sort of poorly called what their quality score is, can actually, again, these quality scores are used heavily from the variant calling perspective to know how to trust some of mismatches, how highly to trust that or weight that when they're calling variants. So cleaning up the quality scores can improve the false discovery rate and the number of mismatches. So all these tiny little steps can look quite complicated when you put it into an automated pipeline. This is a best practices pipeline, fast queues enter, VCFs exit, that includes BWA and GATK. So why are there so many different steps? Well, this is because all these different steps have been proven at one point or another to improve the final product. So you get your fast queue files and you produce some quality charts, you run it through BWA, then you clean up and produce this index, you do that local indel realignment, then you mark PCR duplicates, then you clean it up and with the variant quality score recalibration, and the final step is you use your variant calling tool like GATK Unified Genotyper to produce the VCFs. This is so complicated that people like Seven Bridges can make a pretty good business case for, we'll define how to do this, and you can certainly play with all these little boxes and arrows, but, use our cloud-based pipeline to stick in your VCFs and get back your fast queues and get back your VCFs. Setting this up on your own cluster can certainly be a chore. So what do you get then with that final VCF file? Well, in fact, you don't necessarily get variants that you're immediately ready to use for your analysis. And this is that variant quality filtering I mentioned earlier. You can think about this in terms of, again, what the downstream application is. But if you're looking at, say, high confidence variants that are going to be putative causal variants in a disease, you really don't want to go down too low in read depth. Yet at the same time, the variant callers are going to give you everything. So this is a histogram of read depth versus the number of variants called in my own exome. And notice here, this is 10. I'm having, you know, tens of thousands of variants called below the 10x read depth. That's sort of the ultra low read depth range. You can certainly get quality stuff there, but at a certain point you want to decide what your hard filters might be. And then you can use sort of heuristical filters as well. When I looked at my own 23andMe data, I started out with about 100,000 variants, and after some hard plus heuristical filters, I got down to about 60,000. Since I had a trio though, it's interesting to look at how the number of Mendel errors dramatically drops as I do this filtering. And in fact, the three exonic Mendel errors that were present were all that issue with multi-allelic sites not being called correctly systematically by the variant caller. Again, if you want to see more about my own exome, I'll be doing a short course at TCGC coming up in June, and then I'll spend a lot more time there. And then I don't want to touch on this too much, but it is important to note that although with AGCs and Ts, the number of transitions, which is defined, you know, in sort of these red lines versus transversions versus transitions, seems like it's sort of a 4-to-2 ratio. In actuality, in biology, you actually get many more transitions than transversions. Well, given that sort of the random mutation or sort of systematic error would have one TSTV ratio versus the biological TSTV ratio, you can kind of get a feel for whether a handful of variants follows sort of a biologically likely TSTV ratio, or if there's a bunch of systematic variant calling issues or sequencing errors, you know, you would see this ratio be very low, right? And so if you're doing your filtering, you can say, I'm going to throw away these, 10,000 variants like I did with the read depth less than 10. I could look at the TSTV ratio of those 10,000 variants and say, oh, the TSTV ratio is really, really low. So obviously I'm throwing away a bunch of false positives. So it's a nice way to sort of do some informational gathering on a set of variants and how likely they are to have false positives in them. And finally, we'll get back into this next, visualization. It is really important to validate the variants you're looking at before sending them on to Sanger sequencing or publishing them. There's just a lot of ways in which they can be flat out wrong, and you can spot those false positives pretty easily by looking at the VCF files in combination with the BAM files and all the great annotations that are available. So you can use this, our own tool to do this. Again, it's free. IGV is also probably the most popular tool for doing this with BAM files. It's a Java-based tool that runs on your desktop. And then the web-based versions are probably king when it comes to just having the most annotations to pull up alongside a given locus. Again, with Genome Browse, you can just click up here and jump out to look at the same site in UCSC or Ensemble. Okay, and I mentioned this earlier, that, you know, unified genotyper can be problematic in certain situations. When I got my 23andMe data, I got my version 1 sort of VCF file, and then 3 months later they gave me an updated, quote, final VCF file. And right at the top of my new VCF file was the scary looking frameshift insertion. Again, this is a protein altering complete loss of function variant in DSP. But when I looked at their report, it was in their VCF file that they sent me, and it was in the report, but it was not at all in my BAM file. And it turns out that there was essentially a bug introduced in GATK, and they were just sort of happy to have a new version of GATK to try out with their new run of the data. So between the version 1 that they sent my data and the version 2, they updated their GATK, but that update introduced a bug which produced this false positive. Not only was it a false positive, it was a scary false positive that went into their report. Again, this is all done under the 23andMe exome pilot. It's not that I expected their data to be perfect, and it's always had lots of warnings that this was sort of a pilot with a research grade stuff, but it does raise the flag that if you're setting up all these secondary tools, there's so many ways in which things can introduce errors. You really need to validate any changes to a pipeline if you're going to do it in sort of a production quality for clinical purposes and potentially even for research purposes. All right, so we could take a quick look at my buggy variant, but what I would like to do is move on and start looking at our trio whole genome samples. And if you want to see my 23andMe stuff, there'll be plenty of times to do that in the future. Okay, what we're going to look at now then is our Ceph trio. This is the same trio that I talked about in terms of the exomes, but I also have the same trio provided from three different sequence service providers, and that was sort of the focus of this talk, is knowing what you get from your sequence service providers. The nice thing is I have the same, you know, these cell lines, you can order them from Coriell. It's the exact same genome, and so we should be looking at the same data, but of course different variant, you know, sequencing technologies, alignment and variant calling strategies will result in different results. I also just wrote a blog about this that got published on Monday, so if you haven't seen that, or if that's not how you got to this webcast, you can go into more details that I explain the background of this trio and the comparison, as well as a lot more charts in that blog, so feel free to check that out. So what I'd like to do now is actually, I have this cool mechanism of being able to poll the audience. We have quite a few number of people on the line, and let's go ahead and see what sequence service providers you guys may be looking at either using or have used. And this is a radio button. You can check multiple providers. So I'm going to go ahead and hit the launch button for this. So you should be able to start answering this question in a matter of seconds. Let's go ahead and see if I get that launched. Okay, so people are starting to answer these questions. And so you get a choice of saying, I've used or have used Complete Genomics. I've used or have used Illumina Genome Network. Illumina Genome Network, just to give you a background, Illumina essentially contracts with labs providing a standardized deliverable of whole genome data. It's only whole genome, but they provide both germline and tumor normal pair analysis. Complete Genomics similarly is only whole genome, but germline as well as tumor and DNA analysis. BGI, Beijing Genome Institute, is a Chinese-based institution, but they are also provide a lot of genome sequencing services, and you may be using them for any number of purposes, whole genomes as well as exomes as well as others. Obviously, local institutions, core labs, means anything that you get that's sort of tied to your institution and located in a way both geographically or sort of politically there. And using your own equipment is you're the type of people who have your own lab. So great, I see the numbers starting to close down here. And so what I'm going to do is I think I can just hit close on this and we'll get the results. And I'm going to share them on my screen so you guys can all see this. This is really interesting, actually. Most people are getting their data from their local institution or core lab. This is actually something I probably expected. I'm also surprised with how many people are using IGN versus Complete Genomics and BGI. And of course, with the sort of democratization of sequencing, I imagine a lot of folks are able to afford a entry-level sequencing machine or may even have a HiSeq around. So, oh, that's interesting. So let's go on and move forward, but this gives a context for as we start talking about our sequencing service providers. So a little more background on what Complete Genomics' deliverable looks like. They provide their own, I mean, they have their own sequencing technology, they have their own alignment and variant calling algorithms, and they have their own file formats. So they're a bit of a bugger to work with. But the nice thing is they produce some pretty darn good data. So they're also completely orthogonal, and so as most good scientists like to do, a lot of people sort of compare at least a couple samples between Complete Genomics and another alternate technology when they're piloting their whole genome sequencing analysis. So they also only provide whole genomes, but they also produce relatively high-quality multinucleotide polymorphisms, indels, copy number variations, and structural variations. I mentioned that they were actually sort of pioneering in this sense. Some people sort of question their sustainability. If you look at their quarterly reports as a publicly traded company, they talk about how many millions they lose each quarter, but that the number of millions is going down, which is generally a good thing. But they've gotten some bridge funding from BGI, and it looks like that's going to go through. And they're very optimistic about sort of going forward. They want to do a lot of sequencing, and they think the world is going to need a lot of whole genomes. So The deliverable is also, again, a little bit more custom than you would get from maybe a core lab that's just giving you VCFs. They have these var versus master var files, and that's containing both VCFs as well as in small insertions and deletions. They don't have BAM files. They provide what they call evidence files, which are based around the individual sites where they called variants, and you have to convert them in a quite cumbersome process. But they also give you these nice, you know, this is a Circos plot. Shows you sort of copy number, read depth, and structural variations if there are any detected information. And I actually use some of their copy number calls to go look at our trio and see the same data showing up in the other platforms. Okay, so IGN I mentioned a little bit already. Although their target is a 30x genome, they claim to have much higher sort of false positive and specificity. And they also run a genotype array alongside it, so a microarray, and they show the concordance between your whole genome variants and your genotype variants. They do also give you CNV and SV calls as well. And again, they're using their own informatic tools here. And again, they also run tuminomal pairs for you. So if you are using your local core lab, you know, there's a good chance they're using sort of the best practices pipelines, such as the BWA-GATK one. This is what my exome looked like, and you generally get, you know, some very clean insertions and deletions, but I don't think that there's really much of a standard in terms of how a core lab sets up calling copy number variations on exomes or genomes or structural variations. It's a bit of a wild west out there, and so you wouldn't necessarily expect this with a deliverable from a core lab. So here's that trio I mentioned earlier, and the nice thing about this trio is NA12878 is probably the most sequenced cell line in human history. I guess that means ever. And, you know, there's a lot of people producing reference material. And in fact, the Genome in the Bottle folks and the Archon X Prize folks are also using NA12878. So while I have some data today, I'll be continuing to add data points for comparing what's the, sort of the true haplotypes for both chromosomes here. And you can even start to think about this in a phased sense, although we don't generally right now. So I have the whole trio for complete genomics in the IGN. I only have NA12878 for the core lab. And for complete genomics, I'm using the whole trio to do some comparisons here, but we can use NA12878 for looking at concordance, and then we can also look at de novo mutations. So I want to spend some time going through the concordance, and then we're going to jump on over to look at this stuff in Genome Browse. So from a concordance perspective, these are just all the variants imported from all three sites. I'm actually surprised that the concordance is this low, but notice there's another 10% shared by the two Illumina platforms. The core lab version, actually, it's worth mentioning, it's not using the same reads exactly, but it's using also Illumina HiSeq 2000, 100 base pair paired end reads, and then using the proper upstream BWA followed by deduplication, recalibration, local indel realignment, and then GATK. But let's look at the genotype qualities, and let me remind you what this means. I mean, a genotype quality is essentially saying how confident we are of a single variant being called. That it's called correctly versus the other possible, you know, variants at that site. And this is a FRED scale version. What that means is the 20, 40, 60 essentially means how many nines. So 20 is actually two nines versus 40, 60, or 80 being sort of like eight nines. So this is like 99% confident, 99.99% confident, etc. So obviously you can go out to as many nines as you like. And in fact, you know, Illumina actually has FRED scores in the 1500 and CGI has FRED scores in the 6000. But if you just normalize these down to 100, you see that the BWA is actually quite confident about most of its variants. IGN has quite a few variants that fall in the sort of medium to low confidence, especially when you think about sort of, 90% confidence or a little less. There's certainly variants here that you would probably filter out. Similarly, Complete Genomics has variants down here, although it looks like they probably did some level of filtering, possibly dropping any heterozygote with less than 99% confidence. And similarly, let's look at the read depths here, and this is the pileup of all those 4 million variants called on BWA. You can see that it's about a 60x genome. IGN advertised as a 30x, maybe a little bit more like a 40x genome in this case, and Complete Genomics giving you about a 40x genome as well. Okay, so if we look at the concordance broken down by individual mutation type, our single nucleotide variants have about 73% concordance. Again, much better, and if you conclude just comparing the two Illumina technologies, we're in the 83% range, or 80% range. And then there's going to be probably a lot of these ones that are exclusive to each pipeline have lower read depth and quality. So if you were to do some hard filters on this, you'd probably clean it up significantly. And here, the indel concordance is actually not too shabby, but this is a concordance only matching the location start site and the indel type. So in other words, I have an indel at this position that's an insertion. One of these might be calling it as an insertion with longer number of inserted bases. But this is trying to be fair here as much as possible. Notice there's a lot more shared here again by the two Illumina ones. And still quite a few that are exclusive to each pipeline. Okay, so this is what we're going to look back at it in Genome Browse. Is I love looking at de novo variants between trios because it really shows, a plethora of the types of false positives you get. In reality, in an individual whole genome, you might expect to only see less than 100 real de novo mutation events per generation. And that's based on a paper recently that was looking at this. Actually, in an autism case, you can see that the number of de novo mutation events are highly correlated with the paternal age, not the maternal age. So those older fathers are potentially having children with higher de novo mutations. But though that's the number where 100 comes from. Others might compute it differently, but it's certainly not 3,000. But look at this. I mean, you have of our total number. This is looking at the trio here that I have for Complete Genomics versus Illumina Genome Network. About 150,000 sites where the trio had essentially, and these are just looking at places where the parent is referenced. Both parents are referenced, and the child is heterozygous. So essentially 150,000 sites, and most of those being false positives, or they have to be false positives. But even the ones that they agree on here, 3,000, is still way more than the expected number of de novo events. And so most of these are going to be false positives. All right. So if we look at the distribution of genotype quality and read depth for those 3,000, I guess it's not surprising that there's a enriched number of reads in this low depth region. I'm surprised though that actually there's this little bin here. Most of these are sort of in the relatively high confidence region, and you'll start to see why as we pick through these a little bit. So this is quite fun. We're going to actually start looking at a whole genome sequence, and you're going to have to forgive the fact that I have now quite a few different BAM files and VCF files loaded up. Just to give you an orientation, Illumina provides not only each genome, but in a separate file, they provide the realignments of that genome. And their variant caller then incorporates both pieces of information. Then I also have the daughter from Complete Genomics, and this is using the Complete Genomics evidence-based files converted to BAMs. And then I also have the daughter from BWA. I'll turn these all on for a second. And this is the high coverage and data for BWA. Sorry, moving too quickly. That is the BWA GATK with local realignments. So here the realignments are done inside the same BAM file. When we get to insertions, you'll notice the difference. I only have sort of the coverage view. You can see I have my pileup view turned off for most of these, just so we can fit lots more data onto the same screen. But we're looking at three different pipelines of the daughter. And then I have the mother and the father, as well as their local realignments for Illumina Genome Network. I didn't have time to get all the daughter's complete genomics converted for all those different guys. But we essentially have the father, mother, daughter, three different opinions. So let's look at this is a real de novo event here, this first site we're looking at. Notice if I place my mouse anchor and start clicking around here, the father has zero reads that are not reference of a G, same with the mother, and every single tool provided a confident heterozygous call here. So there's a de novo event, hands down. Also, if I start turning on VCF files, I have this one VCF file which calls all three samples in the same file. This is a multi sample VCF file. And the way we represent this is we have three samples here. Here's our N2, this is a daughter, mother, and father. And you can see the reference genotype. If I hover over this one, this is a heterozygous genotype. And we can actually see information provided by the VCF file on the genotype quality for each sample. Similarly, IGN provides single sample VCF files and confusingly have both a two different versions of a genotype call. MaxGT essentially assumes nothing about the site, and Poly assumes that there might be a polymorphism at that site, but in this case they're both agreeing, and they are most of the time anyway, that this is a heterozygous genotype call. Okay, so nice clean example of a genotype call. Now I have a couple other I'm going to start copying and pasting into our coordinates here and look at a different site. So let's look at this site, and this is just one of my absolute favorites. I'm going to place it so we can see what we're looking at. Now, here's the trio, and remember, these are the 3,000 sites where both Complete Genomics and Illumina agreed that there's a de novo mutation. So here it looks like, you know, the daughter's AG and the parents are referenced. Let's hide this one for now. Again, the daughter's AG here. If we scroll down, now I'm starting to be confused because the mother certainly does happen to have a very clean and high quality SNP here, or, you know, heterozygous genotypes. The daughters is agreed on by all three platforms. Let's hide this one and this one for now, and just look at these three. And if I look at the realignment of the mother at this site, and let's go ahead and add back in for my mother the coverage data here and start to read that, the read data. It's very clean what's going on, but the upstream, there's a bit of a mess. And the reason there's a bit of a mess is because the aligner picked up that there might be an indel here. So sure enough, it did a local realignment, and we can turn on the pileups for that local realignment as well. And the local realignment clearly detects that there's a heterozygous 15 base, which is cool that you can even detect this with short reads, deletion, just a couple bases upstream of this SNP. But notice that this SNP in the mother, none of the reads that support the G mismatch are also supporting this messiness in the heterozygous. And in fact, all of these reads that support in the realignment, the deletion, do not support a G. So if we hide that, what's really going on is the daughter does not have that, did not inherit this 8 base deletion upstream, but so it got called this heterozygous properly, but the mother, the variant caller, and this is a heuristic-based method, usually does not like to call variants that are near insertion events, because insertion events can so often confound, as you can see with this big mess up here, the variant caller. So it essentially didn't call this, even though if you were looking at this in a haplotype specific manner, the haplotype, the chromosome that had the deletion, clearly did not support the genotype or the mismatch, versus the chromosome that did have that was completely clean. So you should be able to call this confidently. Again, someplace where just our variant callers absolutely need to get better if we're going to expect to handle all these events cleanly. Let's also look at this next site here. Jump to this next one. And in this one, it takes a second to load up all these files because I'm displaying a lot of coverage here. I'm going to set my mouse anchor. Notice to start with, the daughter is actually only called heterozygous by one of the two different preferential methods that they give you with IGN. But if I turn on my trios from Complete Genomics, Complete Genomics did call it heterozygous in the daughter and reference in both the mother and father. So hide that for now. So the site for the daughter looks very clean, actually. I would believe it is a heterozygous genotype. So what's going on? Is this a de novo event? My mother realignment shows nothing, so there's no indels nearby. But my mother does show a what looks like a heterozygous event, but it's just simply at a lower ratio of G's and of the mismatch of a G to an A, you know, if 8 reads supporting the mismatch versus 17, and probably just through some heuristics, the variant caller felt that that was probably more likely to be sequencing error than to be a true heterozygous. Although given the fact that we have the whole trio, you should be able to call this with really high confidence as both a heterozygous in the mother and the daughter, and notice the father, actually even the father has, a low ratio, but a heterozygous event. So this is one of those ones where, you know, it just, you kind of throw your hands up because there's, you would think the variant caller should get this site. There is a little bit of sequencing error going on, and some of these reads that support it are low quality reads nearby. So there's probably some things confounding the variant caller heuristics at this site. But it's certainly, if you were to call this in a trio aware manner, and there are some companies that are working on that, you should be able to get this with higher confidence. Okay, notice that the genotype quality of the homozygous call for the daughter here is really low. It's 9. They think the heterozygous call is 25, but it's just frustrating because if you look at the mother, you know, it was not called. Okay, so let's move on. And I want to show an example of low base quality, also potentially confounding this site. So here, I'm going to set this site in. Zoom in, set my anchor so I just know where I'm looking at. Let's get the context of this site. I'm looking at the daughter here, and you can see there's sort of this messiness going on in the reads, and these are essentially reads that have, when they're shaded out like this, they're mismatches, but they're so low quality at a per base level, the sequencing quality is so low that we're shading them out because you shouldn't be paying too much attention to them. At this site, it was called a de novo mutation. The daughter definitely looks like a het. The mother, you would look at this and be like, well, I don't know, is this a heterozygous? And it, there's the there is definitely support for the G, but the G is at a mean quality of the individual bases of 2. So here it's like, well, if the mean quality is 2, you would always throw that away. But given that you have the daughter's information here, the likelihood is that one of the, either the father or the mother, do have a G here, and the sequencing quality is just too low by chance that you wouldn't call it. Probably more likely than this is a true de novo event. Although you could probably figure out those statistical laws and still call this as a true de novo event. This would be a very tricky spot to have pure confidence by just looking at the NGS region. Here's another place that has a interesting site. Again, this is another site where the daughter is called heterozygous and the mother and father are called homozygous. Here, the mother looks like it has something going on. Let's pull on the local realignments to see if it picked up anything. No, it didn't. There might be something going on. Either this is a mismatch with low quality, or there might be a mobile element insertion or something going on here. On the father's side, let's add the reads in so we can take a look. So again, we're looking for a place where the father most likely is heterozygous, and this is a bit scary, but there's essentially one read out of this whole stack, and it's a relatively low depth region. If you can see, this region is probably confounded by a GC bias. In fact, let's add in the reference sequence track at this site and look to see what our GC, yeah, absolutely, look at this. You can see the histograms of G's and C's here are much higher. So this is a hard to sequence region. You zoom into the individual bases and you can just see the repeats that's going on, GG, CC, etc. And it's a repetitive region too. You can see there's a pattern here, GGA, GGA, GGA. So darn hard region to call, and that's probably why we're getting a false positive here. If you zoom out, you can see the coverage dips for all samples. Although we called it pretty accurately with the child, we just didn't happen to get reads that gave us enough confidence to call it in the father. And even though this probably is a true sequence of the second chromosome, and that G actually represents the allele at that chromosome, it's not enough for this variant caller to call it het. So these are all great examples. And I want to show you some other fun things you can see with this whole genome data. I'm going to collapse out the pileups, and we'll just look at the reads themselves here, or the coverage. I'm going to pull up some copy number, actually mobile element insertion. This is really neat. Now, mobile element, essentially you have retrotransposons, which you know, essentially insert chunks of DNA into your chromosome, and those don't match the reference, obviously, because they happened sort of de novo from one generation to another. Now, this site was called as a mobile element insertion of ALU by Complete Genomics. Now, this is not a type of report you get with the Illumina Genome Network, but I'm looking at the Illumina Genome Network data here, and you can certainly see, and the mobile element insertion is supposed to be right around this area, there's a lot of messiness. In fact, three reads at least were aligned here with extremely high mismatches, but also notice the dip in coverage. So probably what's going on is there's even more going on, but the reads didn't align with confidence. If I scroll down, you can see that the mother is very clean at this site, not much going on, but the father has the same pattern. So this is an inherited mobile element insertion at this site, and the father passed it on to the daughter. So that's just a great example of a place that, if you were to look at this from a SNP calling perspective, you might call all these as heterozygotes, but really what's going on is this site just varies different from the reference based on a big chunk of ALU being inserted into this sample that's not in the reference sequence. And let's look at a copy number mutation, and I like this example here. This is, again, copy number data that was called with Complete Genomics. We're looking at it in terms of the Illumina data, and I'm looking at the coverage for the daughter, the mother, and the father. And this is actually a recessively inherited copy number deletion, where the mother and the father have a heterozygote deletion and the daughter, no data. You can actually see these mismatches are another example of mismatches that are not caused by differences to the reference. This is actually reads that span the breakpoint, but of course on their tail ends, they're completely different from the reference. You can kind of probably guess the breakpoint here of where this copy number or where this chunk of the DNA is deleted. Deleted here, heterozygous here, and you can see the coverage is enough that you would believe that there's maybe a dip here. It's pretty hard to call this without having a baseline, but a very clean deletion in the daughter, heterozygous in the father and mother. Let's see if I have another copy number example. I don't have one highlighted. Let's see, there is one right here. Look at, here's another heterozygous. All right. This is actually heterozygous in all three samples, and it's tricky to see again, but at the coverage level, you can see it's about half the level of reads. Okay, so that gives you some great examples of seeing, you know, variants both small and large, using a genome browser to validate them. How, as a tool, though, there's a lot of things that can confound this. You know, these dips here could be GC bias, you know, a number of reasons why you might have dips here. Let's go ahead and just wrap this up from a presentation perspective, and we'll start taking some questions. And get back to my PowerPoint if possible. Too many things open. All right. There we go. Now, there's a couple things to keep in mind. Like I mentioned, ALU and other repeats can not only confound variant calling, they can actually, if you want to detect ALUs in their copies and repeat tandem repeats in their copies, microsatellites, etc., you really need some tools specific to that. We already mentioned things that are specific to RNA-seq. And what's exciting is the number of tools that are starting to look at genomes in terms of phased variant calling, where things like those two insertions that are one base pair apart would be called as a single block, or you would always know that in conjunction they are not frameshift insertions, but just possible in-frame insertions. And finally, you know, the MHC region, and I didn't talk about this too much, but can confound for a lot of reasons. It has just an enormous amount of allelic heterogeneity. There's also an enormous amount of pseudogenes of those HLA genes. And so looking at this reference, which is a single haplotype, remember, spliced together of a couple, you know, people, is a really hard way to actually catalog mutations in terms of those genes. And so you really need a whole different set of tools to call HLA types, as it were. Finally, somatic variants. As we are looking at these things, if you imagine you're taking a sample of a whole shotgun sequence of a tumor cell, but you don't have a pure, you know, tumor cellularity, you have this clonal heterogeneity where some of the cells might actually be different lineages of that same tumor, and some of them are going to be actually germline cells, it's going to be even more difficult to call even just single nucleotide variants and indels, because you essentially look at something that might have a ratio of 3 reads supporting a mismatch to 100, and that might actually be a valid somatic mutation, but a germline variant caller would never call that because the ratios are just way below the sort of even balance you would get if just looking at a clean germline diploid variant. So there's tools like Somatic Sniper, and what they do is they actually compare both BAM files, almost like we're looking at when we're looking at the pileups, and they're looking at places where one, the somatic, you know, the cell line or the cancer file has reads that are, and they're normalizing that against the ref, the germline file, and so they can call things with much higher confidence. But this is a secondary analysis tool. If you just get your germline based variant caller tools and throw them at somatic or, you know, at cancer cells, you're going to have a harder time doing your downstream analysis. So to finish it up, let's talk about, you know, there are some next steps I hope you can think about. One is, you know, if you want to look at, hear me talk about sort of more on the interpretation side, go into more of the issues with exome sequencing, I do quite a lot of that in my short course coming up at the Clinical Genome Conference, and that's just in a couple months, so keep an eye out for that. It's a great conference, by the way. I attended it last year, and it's expanded dramatically given how popular it was. Similarly, I'll be giving a short course, a full 3-hour one, giving much the same content but in a more interactive manner and with updated content later this year in Providence, Rhode Island. And follow our blog. I post these types of blog posts as well as many others on blog.goldenhelix.com. And absolutely go play with Genome Browse. We'd love to hear your feedback. It's a tool we use to essentially let people know the type of quality of software we build. We put a lot of man years of effort into it, and we're going to be using it as our visualization engine for our products going forward. But as an independent tool to just visualize data, it's absolutely a great standalone application. We're going to keep it free forever. So with that, let's start taking questions. And let me pull up my question panel here and make sure I have some questions coming in. I'm going to need to give me a second to orient my screen here so I can take these. All right, so just about 200 questions. This will only take a year or so to answer, so please be patient for a second. And all right, I'm going to start. I'm going to try these chronologically, and then I might need to start skipping as we go. All right, so we have some... Where's strand bias for NGS reads? That's a great question. So strand bias would be one of the things that the variant caller would put in one of those info fields or per sample fields. If you click on an individual variant, especially ones produced by BWA-GATK, there will often be a strand bias metric. In fact, I could probably pop open back to our BAM files here. Actually, I might even pop on my own files here. But if I look on any of these individual sites that are called, yeah, sorry, I don't have the VCF file around. Strand bias would be one of the things you would see in there. You can also use it as a filtering, a heuristical or, you know, hard filtering one as well, to say drop variants where the strand bias is very high. It's important to note, though, that for exomes, strand bias will lose some very important variants. Even just looking at this site here, for example, there's a strand bias associated with this deletion. At the same time, the reason is it's at the tail end of the capture of this exon, and so the reason there's strand bias is because one of the paired end pairs hit the target, got captured, and the other end sits way out here in the intronic space, but it's still a very clean variant, and there's no reason why you wouldn't trust it. Let's see if I can find another example. Not one here. So for exomes, I wouldn't use strand bias as a hard filter, because for genomes, it's where you expect sort of even coverage. It's definitely much more appropriate. Okay, where do I get the slides? We'll get the slides up. We'll get the whole presentation up, and we'll get that out to people who have attended. We'll send you an email letting you know that's available. All right, so people are starting to download Genome Browse as we speak. Love to hear that. Okay. Question about audio. Do people have any problems with audio? Certainly, it looks, sounds like we got that resolved right off the bat. Okay. Can we insert a new reference genome in the Genome Browser? Good question. Right now, we currently only support the references that we've curated, and we can curate references, or you can curate references using our SNP and variation suite, but there is no There's no way for you to build your own reference sequence right within Genome Browser. As we start to build out Genome Browser as our core visualization engine, we'll be adding in more features like that. All right. And why are there CPG islands so hard to get? CPG islands are hard to get mostly because it's difficult for the PCR sample preparation to handle those sites. So you're actually, it's part of the sample prep site where you actually don't get reads going into the sequencer for those areas with high GC content. As we start to think about sequencing data or samples that have no library preparation, sort of amplification-free sequencing, that's one of its benefits. It definitely has its own downsides, too. It's much difficult. There's definitely some difficulties there, too. How to deal with soft clipping in SAM files? Well, soft clipping is, again, what an alignment tool like BWA does at the tail end of read as the read quality drops. There's no reason why it's a problem. Most aligners ignore anything that has been soft clipped off of a read. We don't even visualize the soft clipped reads here. They would just show a lot of mismatches, but you can click on individual reads and see if they've been soft clipped. You'll see that in the cigar string. In this case, there's not. It's just a 76 base pair match. So that they really don't actually cause any problems from an analytical perspective. How do you measure indel concordance with the variety between how tools are... Yeah, so I mentioned this a little bit. We were measuring indel concordance as two sites being called with the same type of of mutation, insertion or deletion. If you look at actually getting the genotypes to be concordant, the concordance actually goes way down. But it's as bad enough as it is, I didn't even want to go there. How would one correctly deal with the problem that an indel position can differ from different platforms aligners, local realignment of indels, and then do overlap analysis? Yeah, so as long as within your same samples and within your controls, you're using the same tools, you're going to be concordant. The trick is, if you look at 1,000 genomes, which also calls indels, if I scroll around here, oh, here's a site that's an indel, right? So imagine we have this indel here. It really depends on how 1,000 genomes defines that. But they have then started, and everyone has started to agree on where to call this. And this site, there's not a homopolymer, so it's not that hard. But you could actually call this insertion of a TT before or after this T in the reference, and they always do it on the before. So so essentially, you do need to be concerned about it, but usually just when validating individual variants, you might see that your pipeline called it at a different site than, say, the 1,000 Genomes Consortium did, but it has been cataloged as a polymorphism and is benign, for example. What do you do with multimap reads for CNV analysis? Throw them away or keep them? Oh, that's a good question. So multimap reads increase your depth of coverage significantly, potentially, at sites that are have huge duplications or high homology to other regions. I am not an expert on calling CNVs on exomes or genomes, but I know there is a number of heuristics used when doing that. One is correcting for that GC bias. Another is just normalizing. And if you do everything consistently, your normalization should handle the fact that a lot of samples will consistently have high coverage for the multimap reads. My tendency would be, though, with those regions that are highly homologous, those multimap reads are not giving you much information. And those regions are probably going to be ripe with false positives from a CNV analysis as well. Could you please comment on how many sites per genome require this level of manual reanalysis? Well, that's a very good question. I mean, at the end of the day, what I'm doing here is showing you the worst of the worst examples, right? I'm picking the de novo mutations out for the most part. And this is for the most part, if you do the level of type of filtering out the common bad cases from sort of a tertiary analysis perspective, you take your VCF, you drop things below read depth of 10 or whatever, you're going to get your interesting variants down to, assuming you're doing some sort of rare variant analysis, an order that's very manageable to go through and inspect them. Now, I'm not giving any promises of how many of the ones you expect inspect turn out to be false positives. That could easily be quite a few. In fact, when I looked at my own exomes, a good 80% of the ones that looked interesting were false positive variants from one reason or another. And, you know, I could essentially learn from those and then refine my filters and reduce that number over time. But you never sort of start at this level. You always do analysis first, find out which sites or which genes you're going to look at, and then come into a genome browser, jump out to a gene view, and see what you're dealing with. I'm just going to keep going. You guys are free to stick around and or tail off if you want to pop out. But if you find these questions interesting, looks like I got another 20 questions or so to answer. So why not keep at it? So, all right, let me make sure I clear out the ones I've already answered here. How do you normalize DNA-seq for copy number? I believe I answered that already. How do you know the ratio of somatic or germline patients to be in de novo mutations? Okay, so again, I'm only looking at germline samples here. When you're looking at somatic mutations, I mean, somatic mutations are by nature de novo compared to the germline. The ratios are going to be relatively specific to potentially the type of cancer and the type of clonal heterogeneity you expect from your biopsy. They can be quite low and still be Sanger confirmed. We're thinking about doing a webcast actually on some exomes that were done in tumor normal pairs, and it's quite surprising looking at the exomes, you know, 80x coverage or 40x coverage, and looking at the fact that you only have 2 out of 100 reads supporting a mismatch, and they reported in their paper that they were able to Sanger confirm that as a somatic mutation. So the ratios can be scarily low, and that's why you need potentially a tool like Somatic Sniper to use that in concordance with your germline data. Let's see. What level of variance do you estimate are sequencing artifacts? Would you expect it to be, you know, between 10 and 15%? I mean, again, there's going to be, it's hard to say what sequence, you know, if you're talking about sequencing artifacts purely in the sense of an Illumina machine miscalls a base, and then you happen to be unlucky enough to have that miscalled base happen, you know, 3 or 4 times at a site. That's going to be quite rare just because the base miscalling should be a relatively independent event. What's not rare is the things that aren't independent because of systematic issues with the reference sequence, GC bias, sample prep bias, other elements of the sample itself, such as insertions or deletions nearby, mobile element insertions, copy number mutations, mappability, all those things I mentioned. Those, I think, are going to systematically still be problematic in, yeah, at least 10% of your total called reads, maybe more. Are there any special features in Genome Browse right now to support cancer genome analysis? Well, again, Genome Browse is not an analysis tool. We're just looking at the data that you have. So if you find that you have somatic mutations called by a tool and you find those to be significant, absolutely, Genome Browse can support validating those. Great presentation. Look awesome. Thank you. Hey, sweet. Thank you. I'm going to go use Genome Browse. Sweet. Very informative. Can you please distribute the slides? Absolutely. And let's see, this seems a beefy question. Can you describe some more things to do? To help filter down your false positives, I believe is the question, right? So if I have 1,000 variants after stringent filtering, I need to get those down to 100 or so to work with them. Can you imagine if we can see everything from looking at it in Genome Browse, why can't we systematically, programmatically filter that? So this is what, you know, us secondary folks that are bioinformatic tools generators are trying to do. I didn't get into it too much, but there is more that I talk about in my blog posts about how I'm pretty confident that we'll be improving the number of false, or I guess improving the rate of false positives as we go forward. GATK is building a new a variant calling tool called their haplotype caller that does do things in a haplotype-specific way. Our reads are getting longer. Our reference genome is getting better. Our ability to call indels is getting better. There's being, you know, more and more tools for doing CNV detection. If you start to include all that and start to look at calling sort of trios in tandem, you can really improve the call ratio between high quality and low quality variants. That's certainly probably not the state of the art now, but it is improving. But certainly you can look at more filters based on more heuristics, and we'll get a little incremental improvements, but there's definitely some that needs to happen at the secondary stage. So best methods for sequencing MHC. I actually go into MHC a little bit more detail when I do my 23andMe analysis because I wanted to get my wife's HLA haplotypes because she has an autoimmune disease, and HLA is one of the highest, obviously the highest region to have genetic association with autoimmune disease. And I have only her BAM files from an exome. And I found that there are companies that specialize in this. Omixon, actually based in Europe, has a tool that aligns essentially your raw reads against every known HLA type out there as its own reference, and then heuristically looks at which one most likely matches your sample and gives you HLA types. You really have to do something like that if you're going to do HLA typing with NGS. You can also go to completely orthogonal technologies to do HLA typing with very specific PCR amplifications, etc. But if you want to hear me talk about that more, again, I'll be doing that at TCGC. Does Genome Browse update automatically? Do I need a download? I'm at 106. Yeah, so we've been thinking about adding an automatic uploader because at the end of the day, I aspire to make Genome Browse as awesome as, a Chrome-like experience, but even more awesome in terms of its ability to handle genomic data in the fluid way in which it can. But it hasn't been something we've gotten in there yet. It might be something you'll see in the next couple versions. At the moment, if you're on 106 or 107, you should see in the bottom right corner a little thing that says update available, and then we'll point you to our download site. Just go ahead and download the latest version, install it over the existing one, and you'll be good to go. You'll be using the latest version. All right, is BWA and GATK paralyzed? Well, BWA and GATK are both open source tools. They're both independent open source tools, and there's a lot of other tools that you might put into a pipeline. So you can run it on your own local network, or you can use someone like Seven Bridges Genomics, who does have a paralyzed cloud-based version. If you upload 20 samples, they'll spin up 20 machines on the Amazon cloud and do those in parallel. It'll still take 20 hours or 30 hours, depending on the input size, but you can still get parallelization at the sample level really easily with the cloud-based providers. Does GenoBrowse take both VCF and BAM? Absolutely. We do take VCF. If I say add from file, you can select a VCF file. And if you have a VCF file, we'll auto-generate the compressed and indexed version for you. The first time we run it, we'll sort of just have a progress bar as we do that. So we read, this is actually version 1.1 where we've added VCF support. We're updating our VCF importer in SVS to use this blazingly fast technology we just built. But you can see things with great detail, and not only do you see just the genotype and the site, you see all the other information, and I've changed those cryptic DP type tags to things like read depth, so you can actually make informative information of what's in the VCF file at a given site. Read depth of 8, there's a strand, here's the strand bias information, it's 0 at this site. Whether there's a multiple MQ rank sum is a multi-map read rank sum, there's none there, and the per sample information about its allelic depth, read depth, genotype quality, relatively low for this site. The genotype itself, which is in terms of the reference versus alternate, is 2 alternate alleles here, etc. So we take VCF files. We've been working hard on that. And Pop, you should be able to handle them. Let us know if you can't. How is SVS different than other callers? Clarification, SVS is not a secondary analysis tool. SVS is a tertiary analysis tool. In fact, everything that you saw me do in terms of comparison of these genomes was done in a project like this in SVS, where I imported a bunch of genomes and then ran a bunch of comparison and then looked at their individual variants, pulled up these histograms that you were looking at, are just histograms that I can display and look at and interact with here in SVS. And it's actually quite a simple tool, but very powerful in its capabilities. You essentially just link up things as imported genotypes and spreadsheets, and we can pull up the tables of individual sites and their genotypes and information for each position. So SVS is our tertiary analysis tool. We don't think it's really the right place for us to be to start building secondary analysis tools. There's a lot of great folks out there doing that, and they're improving their pipelines quite tremendously. But we use SVS to import VCF files, get started from there. All right. Can we look at the MHC region from the whole genomes data set? Sure. Why don't we stick around a little bit and do that? Load up this. type in HLA, DR beta 1, one of the most important genes from an autoimmune perspective. Oh, and it looks like crap, right? Well, this is what you expect with the HLA region. Notice every single site has mutations. There's mutations galore. They're all at different ratios. DR beta 1 has one of the highest pseudogene rate of any HLA gene. That's why I sort of jumped here. You can kind of just, you know, get a feel for what's going on here. Interesting that the daughter seems to have a higher mutation rate than the mother and father here. It's certainly a mess trying to. You don't necessarily trust these genotypes at an individual level here. There's just there's better ways to look at the MHC region than look at the BAM files. I can pull up the CGI BAM file and the BWA BAM file. I haven't actually looked at this region here. I wonder what it looks like. So here's the CGI BAM file loading. Again, it's a mess. Here's the BWA file loading. Again, it's a mess. I don't know if you would really call one of these better than the other, but you know, there you go. How did you use Unified Genotyper from GATK? So I did actually run Genotyper myself to call variants for this BWA data. The BAM file was provided, hosted by Thousand Genomes. It was actually done in a sort of benchmarking paper. It's actually a 300 gigabyte BAM file. One of the things I love about GenoBrowse 1.1, by the way, if I click on this BAM file, I can click on it and it shows me all this great details of what's in the header here. So here's the header information for this BAM file, and you can see what tools were run. GATK indel realignment, table recalibration, and BWA, as well as, you know, the actual references that were used. So this is the, you know, chromosome 1 through XY, plus they have some super contigs and a mitochondrial that's length 16569. So this is technically a G1K reference. So these BAM files already have all that work done for them, and I just used a standard Unitype genotyper pass to call the VCF files. Remember, that's the last step in the whole lineage of things you do to produce these core lab type genomes. Do you recommend systematic reanalysis of your BAM files with different parameters and variant calling? Well, it really depends. It depends what you're trying to get out of it. You know, if you can get by with your single pass and do some analysis and then use something like GenoBrowse to see what's left, that's certainly an important step. If you want to then get five different people's opinions and find tools to do that, there's certainly going to be plenty of other folks out there tools to do that. It is computationally expensive to do this, by the way. I mean, whole genomes rerunning analysis can take weeks and cost hundreds of dollars. So there's a cost benefit comparison here that you have to make. Okay, so what's the difference between SNP calling between BWA and a bow tie? Well, that's a very good question. Remember, bow tie one, it will not do gapped alignment. So you have to add a local realignment step if you want to have indel calls with bow tie. That's why BWA is the more popular tool for calling variants directly with the genome. There will be a difference in SNP concordance if you choose anything to be different upstream of your SNP caller. That's just, unfortunately, the reality. What that difference is, I wouldn't be able to tell you off the top of my head. Is GenomeBrowse free for public use? Free for public use, free for commercial use, free for academic use. It's pretty much just free. Does the alt allele often get lower read coverage compared to the ref? Now, there's no reason why that would be something you would assume by default. If you have a heterozygous or homozygous presence of your in your sample, it's either on one or two chromosomes, it should just as easily be covered by your sequence, whole genome shotgun sequencing, as the reference. So often when you're looking at high quality mutations, there's not a single read, you know, in a homozygous mutation, for example, that supports the reference. It's all alternate. So there's no systematic biases why alternative reads are more difficult to call. It's all about ratios and all these other things. Are all these annotation tracks available for downloads? Oh, absolutely. So let me show you this real quick. Go to the annotation track tab here. We're loading 147 annotation tracks pre-loaded from data.goldenhelix.com. You can notice that 1000 Genomes G1K is right here. You can notice there's 1000 Genomes reference or population catalog stuff here. So things like this latest 2012 is their latest phase one release of the population catalog. We have dbSNP. We also have these great things like dbNSFP, which give you functional predictions at every single site. We use those in SVS, so that's why we're curating them, but you get them for free for Genome Browse, and they do things like give you functional predictions to tell you whether a non-synonymous variant is potentially damaging. We also have a number of useful catalogs here about genes and annotations, etc. With current analysis technology, does it make any sense to use exome capture versus other tools because of the the issues with exome captures on UTR sites? Yeah, that's a very good point. Now, it really, again, I'm going to talk about exomes a lot more in my discussion of my own, but there are definitely biases in the coverage here between this exon 5, which is sitting here right near this UTR3 side, versus the UTR5 side of this exon. And it might not be the best example, but and the exon captures have difficulty with the UTRs in general because they tend to have a high level of repeat sequences that are sometimes repetitive, right? There's certainly biases in exome capture. They're usually pretty systematic in that the same, multiple samples will have the same biases. If you need, from a clinical perspective, to have high coverage over a specific region, you may need to supplement your exome capture with a targeted amplicon. That's actually an approach I saw used at the XGen conference I went to last week. They took their exome capture, which gave them about 90% coverage over 20x, and then they added amplicons for all the regions they needed to get that were not getting high coverage, and they put those two data sets together, and then now they're getting their coverage at above 99%. So then they could be confident to use that in a clinical application. Now, from a research perspective, that might be overboard and way too much, cost and problems. All right, we're getting down here, and I appreciate everyone sticking around. I think I got enough questions that I just want to answer a couple more, and then we'll call it good. How do you differentiate platform software tools? How do you do the different platforms and software tool match with array genotypes? Good questions. And I actually was able to compare my exomes against my own genotypes. But Illumina, they'll report their concordance between their genotypes and their sequencing. And their genotypes, common SNPs that are on the genotype arrays are generally sites that you can get a pretty good probe to pull down that data, so they end up being relatively easy sites to sequence and variance call as well. Concordance is absurdly high. Not perfect, but absurdly high. And so you really, if you're using sequencing as a genotyping platform, you can be pretty confident what's going on there. When is it right to remove PCR duplicates? Oh man, that is a good question. I actually spent a lot of time researching PCR duplicates. Basically, people just decided that when you remove them, you actually remove some false positive rates, so why not remove them, right? You just remove, they showed that you could, there are sites that are confounded by PCR duplicates, so removing them is always a good thing. Now, that was usually earlier on in sort of sequencing technology development, and this recommendation comes from a couple years ago. If someone were to do a comparison of running a whole pipeline with and without PCR duplicate and having a known good data set to test false positive rate, it'd be very interesting to publish that and let us all know whether it still makes sense with modern alignment and sequencing technologies to do that step. But the general consensus is it doesn't hurt, so why not do it? Again, though, it does add computational cost, so maybe it does hurt. All right, we're going to have to wrap this up. We're down here, and sorry there isn't time to go through all these questions. I did mention a lot of these. I think these questions are starting to look like duplicates, but let's go ahead and wrap it up. Appreciate everyone for joining us for this call. As you can see, I try to cover quite a lot, and feel free to download Genome Browse, follow up on those next steps, and we'll put this recording online, including the Q&A section. So if you thought there was something you heard and wanted to catch again in more detail, we'll do that. All right, thank you very much for joining us today, and take care.